Hi guys, I bought my first knitting machine last year. It is a Brother KH910, which is an electronically controlled flatbed knitting machine, manufactured in 1980. One of the reasons I bought it over some of the other models is actually because it is electronically controlled, so hopefully I can swap it out with something a bit more modern. And in fact, this has already been done by the folks at AYAB. I will link their project below. But I'm an engineer, and most of the fun for me is doing it myself. The biggest limitation I have run into so far has been trying to find the pattern cards. They are this mylar kind of film that you color in. They're not reusable and they are not manufactured anymore, which makes them very, very hard to find. This makes the pattern subsystem a very good candidate for my first project on this machine. Let's start with a quick overview of the machine. Over here is the main board. You can think of it as the brains of this operation. It takes inputs from sensors throughout the 910 and makes decisions about how to behave based on those inputs. You can see this big chip, which is probably a microcontroller. There's another one on the right side of the board, plus a whole mess of integrated circuits that I'm not ready to dig into yet. Over here is the pattern scanning system. It is driven by two motors. The gold color stepper motor here is for feeding in and advancing the pattern card. And the silver motor down here pushes the optical sensor back and forth to read each line. Now, what is an optical sensor? An optical sensor is basically a combination of a light source and a photosensitive diode that converts light into an electrical signal. Different surfaces will reflect different amounts of light, which will produce different output voltages. Looking at the pattern card through the reed, there are three distinct surfaces: the reflective silver reed, the semi-transparent mylar sheet, and the colored sections of the mylar sheet. When the sensor moves from side to side, the signal is passed to this PCB through these three wires. Let's take a quick peek at what the signal looks like. This is a cable harness that I stole from one of my husband's projects. There are loose wires on one end and two connectors on the other end. This allows me to insert a test point between the original connector and the optical sensor. I have routed the wires from here to the original connector and checked my work with a multimeter. The second connector is for my logic analyzer, which will be able to record the electrical signals over time. I have this wire connected to ground and these two connected to channel 0 and channel 1. I've made the assumption that this one is ground because it's connected to these screws, and it would be objectively silly if they were connected to something other than ground. Because I've spent a bit of time playing with this before filming, I know that channel 0 will be the 5-volt power line and channel 1 will be an analog signal that oscillates between 0 and 4 volts. To capture this, I have set up the software to trigger on a falling edge on channel 1, which means transitioning from a high voltage to a low voltage, and it will record for half a second. Now I'm going to move the knitting carriage back and forth to get the pattern to advance, which will move the optical sensor. The capture shows 60 pulses that correspond to each grid on the pattern card. When the signal is at its highest, the optical sensor is directly in front of the silver reflective reed. The next step down is about 1.7 volts and corresponds to the uncolored squares. And the lowest voltage is about 0.1 volts corresponding with the colored squares. You can see that most of the colored squares occur on the left here. This is the row of pattern that we just read, and you can see that there is a cluster of colored squares on the left and nothing to the right, which matches the signal that we just saw. This second capture looks like a mirror of the previous line. This is because the optical sensor moved from right to left this time, reading the pattern data out in the opposite direction. Now we know how to send a pattern, but not when to send the pattern. For that, we need to figure out how the motor works. There are two leads that plug directly into the main board, which probably means it's a DC motor. DC motors move based on the voltage differential across the two leads. So if you were to connect the first lead to power and the second lead to ground, it would move in one direction. If you were to reverse the leads, it would move in the other direction. I inserted another test point, but this time I'm going to start with my multimeter. My logic analyzer is only rated for plus or minus 25 volts, so I want to make sure that the motor operates within that range before hooking up the analyzer. I attached each lead to the multimeter, and I can't find my alligator clips for the life of me, so tape it is. Plus or minus 13 volts looks pretty promising, but I do need to run one more test. Since the multimeter is comparing the two leads, we only know that they change a maximum of about 26 volts from each other, but we don't know where that differential falls relative to the common ground. For the next test, I'm attaching the multimeter ground to this grounded screw. Now we have plus 13 volts max and about 0 volts minimum. That looks pretty good to me. Let's hook up the analyzer. So it looks like this motor signal is held at about 10 volts while the other motor signal oscillates around 5 volts. This means that even when the machine is sitting idle, the motor is active and pushing against the motor stop. Here, you can see the signals flip to drive the motor across. After the pattern is sent, the motor stays active. I expect to see the opposite behavior in the next pattern movement. Yep, this time the other signal starts at 10 volts and flips to ground. Also, if you notice, there is a slight wavy pattern here right before the motor moves, and then it's flat. I'm guessing that has to do with the characteristics of whatever current limiting circuit is hooked up to the other side of this motor. Now I should have all of the information that I need to create a replacement for the pattern system. I have a couple of these Arduinos sitting around, so next step is going to be programming it to accept the motor as an input and generating the pattern signal as an output. I might even try to create a way to upload patterns via USB if I'm feeling fancy. Thank you guys for hanging out to the end of the video. This is the first one I've made, so I don't know what a sustainable posting cadence will be for me. But I am planning on making several more videos as I continue working on my KH910, the next one being the project with the Arduino. I have a lot of other hobbies as well, mostly focused around fiber arts. If you're interested in some of my other projects, I have linked my TikTok below. Thank you again for watching, and please subscribe if you want to follow along.